Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and from the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. You may be seated. Having already confessed the Nicene Creed and its extensive explanation of the second article, rather than do the whole article again, we'll just do the meaning, if you would, from the small catechism. What does this mean?
I believe that Jesus Christ, who is God, begotten of the Father from eternity, and also to the man, born under the Virgin Mary, is my Lord, who has redeemed me, lost and never purchased, purchased and won in me, from all the sin from the death, and from the power of the devil, not of the world of the suffer, but with his holy precious blood, and with his innocent suffering and death, that I may be his own, and live with him in his kingdom, and serve him in everlasting righteousness, innocence, and blessedness, just as he is risen from the dead, lives and reigns to all eternity. This is most certainly true.
Yes, it is most certainly true. Those words, I guess I think of those as concisely bringing about what every sermon probably should project: who Christ is, what he has done, and what that actually means for you and for me. The basis for this morning's sermon, though, is that of Luke chapter 2, which we have already read. Now, certainly, we know that God knows all things. Even before he created man, he knew what was going to happen. Yet he did. So when he creates Adam and he breathes life into Adam, his intent, even though he knew Adam would sin, his intent was that Adam would live forever. Adam's sin, however, his disobedience to God, his doubt of God's word and promise, changed things. With that sin came death. When Adam sinned, he brought death upon himself, and he brought death upon all mankind. He brought about a spiritual death, that is, a separation from God. Through his doubt of God's word and of God's promise, his doubt of God, his lack of faith, he created a chasm between himself, that is, between all mankind and God, such that none knows God as God has intended. None knows God as Adam did in the beginning, face to face. But with that spiritual death also comes the curse. That curse that physical death will come upon each one of us. And without a reparation, without something to make up for man's sin, these two deaths, the spiritual and the physical, would then lead also to an eternal death, an eternal separation from God and his goodness. Each of us, when we were born, we began a journey. And like Adam, a journey in life. But unlike Adam initially, also a journey towards death. Our death, it's undefined for us, or at least ill-defined. Some of us are a lot closer to it now than we were 20 years ago. But none of us knows when it shall come. But death itself is not our purpose. But I want to make that distinction. While death will come to us, and every day we make one step closer to death, death is not the purpose for man or the purpose of man. If we were death itself, you know, it might come at a good, comfortable old age, or it might come at a relatively young age. It may occur as a result of disease or of accident, or simply because the body has worn out under the ravages and the tolls of this life. But the purpose of our birth is not to achieve death. say is elusive for many people. Many people go through life trying to figure out that purpose for life, trying to figure out what their purpose is. But the purpose for man, in simple fashion, the meaning for our life is that we would have a relationship, that we would have communion with God, that we would know him as he had intended face to face. For us, death might be a looming specter, but death is not why we were born. It is not so, however, for the Christ child. As his title implies, Christ is the anointed one. He was anointed for a purpose. He was anointed by God, chosen for this purpose. He was born so that he would die. It is for death that he was anointed. It is for death itself that he was anointed. And it is not a casual death, an unforeseen death, but a purposeful, an agonizing, and a punishing death. This child was born to die. It is the very purpose for which he was born. It is not the result of the futility that most people search after and try to accomplish things that bring about. But it is for these things, truly, for man's futility, that he would die. It is to accomplish the purposeful life for each of us that this child was born to die. It is for the purpose of restoring for us a real life, a true life, a life that is in relationship with the eternal God, not just for a moment, but for eternity. For this reason, this child was born, and for this reason, this child was appointed for death. As the firstborn son of Mary, a price was to be paid, a ransom to be offered for him. In this case, as the law described, two small birds. But it was a temporary reprieve for him. But for you, the ransom price of his blood spilt and in sacrifice, that is an eternal redemption. It is a ransom that privileges you, as the scriptures tell us, to be known as sons. Even on par, then, as the firstborn. The talk of death itself scares many people. The thought of it changes the behaviors of masses of people. But for us Christians, it is well described in the evening hymns of our hymnal. Those that speak of death as but a slumber, and where we offer prayers to God that he would teach us to live, that we would dread the grave as little as our bed, because of this child, because this child was anointed for death in our place. As Paul would write, death itself has been defeated. It no longer has a sting. This is the position. This is the statement, the confession of Simeon in our text. According to God's word, he was privileged to see the consolation of Israel, the one who would redeem Jerusalem, that is, would redeem the city of peace. And he would redeem all who dwell in that city of peace. That would include Simeon and Anna in our text, those who believed, those who have waited for the Lord's promise to be fulfilled. The city of Jerusalem is not simply this physical location, though. It is that place of peace where God dwells with his people. It is the church. And so it is also you who believe, you who are patiently waiting for God's promise to be fulfilled and for you. That it would come to its final completion when faith shall become Now, one aspect of peace, if I was to kind of create a synonym that doesn't complete it entirely, would be calm. Peace would be a calmness, right? We refer to a lake as being peaceful when there's no wind and there's no waves. The water itself is like glass, it is calm. We can say the same of Simeon. For Simeon here, he has no anxiety. He's not anxious about anything. For him, there is no hidden unknown. Certainly, there are many things in this life that we don't know which way they're going to go. Certainly, there are things about God that we do not know. But as Simeon declares, and as we confess, we do know that this child has died for us that we might live. Simeon has seen his salvation, and he is now prepared to depart in peace. Now, most of us think, and as the cover of your bulletin would kind of assume, Simeon was an elderly man. But the scriptures don't make any indication that he was of any particular age. So we shouldn't think that Simeon was just close to death, and so now he was ready to die. But in seeing the consolation of Israel, seeing the salvation of all mankind being before him and held in his arms, it doesn't matter his age. He no longer fears what this world can throw against him. He no longer fears what the devil might throw against him. He does not fear death. He's at peace, knowing that God has provided for his salvation. This celebration of Christmastide is all about showing you this child, the one who is anointed, the one who is appointed for your salvation, so that you might know and you might possess the same peace that Simeon has known, so that all of your anxieties about life and about death may be quelled, that you may know peace. There is one who has been anointed for death, and not any death, but the death of the sinner. There is one who has been appointed to be the ransom of all God's children. He has been anointed, and he has been appointed as such for you, that you may have peace both now and in the hour of death. These words of Simeon should be words that are very familiar to you. They are the words of the Nunc Dimittis, which we sing during the communion liturgy. As Simeon held the child and beheld his consolation, his forgiveness, his salvation, we sing it too after having received communion, because there we too have received this child in the body and blood that has been broken and shed for us. We too have held and beheld our salvation, that which God bestows for us in his beloved Son, Jesus Christ. So behold your salvation. Amen. We stand. Peace of God, which passes all understanding.